Hello friends, welcome to my channel. And today in this session we are going to discuss ventricles of the brain, that is ventricular system. We are going to discuss under following headings. First we will see what is this ventricular system or ventricles and the different types of ventricles, how they are communicated with each other, and all the ventricles, they produce cerebrospinal fluid. What is that? What is the composition? What is the function and how it flows through the CNS? And we will see the third ventricle, one of the ventricles of the brain, its presenting parts and relations in detail. So let us begin with what are these ventricles and why they are needed. So these ventricles are series of communicating cavities within the central nervous system that are lined by ependymal cells, which produce, contain and circulate cerebrospinal fluid. So ependymal cells are one of the neuroglial cells. They are lining the ventricles, and when you see the left lateral view of the cerebral hemisphere, you can see the ventricles there. You can see the pair of lateral ventricles, third ventricle and a fourth ventricle. We will see that in the types of ventricle. So here you are seeing the C-shaped lateral ventricle. This is the third ventricle in the median plane. And here you are seeing the fourth ventricle. And these all are communicated with each other by the communications, and they help in the production and circulation of the CSF. So you can see here in this GIF image, you can see the pair of lateral ventricle there, C-shaped, and a median central third ventricle, and below that you are seeing the fourth ventricle, which is here. This is the fourth ventricle. So coming to types of ventricle, as I already showed you in the image, there is a third ventricle, pair of lateral ventricle, each in the cerebral hemisphere, a fourth ventricle between the cerebellum and pons, medulla, that we have discussed in the brainstem, and a terminal ventricle, that also called as the fifth ventricle or ventricle of cross, that is at the beginning of the conus medullaris, in the lower part of the vertebral column or lower part of spinal cord. And all these are connected by series of communications. So when you see the ventricles here, on the left side you can see the left lateral view of the entire ventricular system. On the right side you are seeing the anterior view of the ventricular system there. So when you see here, this is the C-shaped lateral ventricle that you see here, one in each hemisphere. It has a body and three horns. It has an anterior horn, body, posterior horn and an inferior horn. And in the median plane you are seeing this third ventricle, which is here. And in the brainstem part, you are seeing the fourth ventricle, that is here. So these are all communicated by the communications that you see. Here you can see the communications are here. The lateral ventricle is communicated with the third ventricle by the interventricular foramen of Monroe. And third ventricle communicates with the fourth ventricle via cerebral aqueduct. And again, from this fourth ventricle, you have communications with the cistern and help in the circulation of the CSF. You can see the communication here. That is the interventricular foramen of Monroe here, which communicates this lateral ventricle with the third ventricle. And you also have the cerebral aqueduct, which communicates third ventricle with the fourth ventricle. So whatever the cerebrospinal fluid produced in the lateral ventricle reaches the third ventricle, then from third ventricle to fourth ventricle. And this fourth ventricle communicates with the terminal ventricle via this central canal of the spinal cord. So these are the communications what you see here, and this is how the cerebral aqueduct communicates third ventricle with the fourth ventricle, then central canal, fourth ventricle with the terminal ventricle. So next you can see here, these are three communications: interventricular foramina, cerebral aqueduct and the central canal. Next, if you see here in this video, you are seeing the brain with its ventricular system. You can see the ventricular system there within the cerebrum. You can see the C-shaped lateral ventricle there, a median third ventricle, and a tent-shaped fourth ventricle in the brainstem. Now you can see this is the entire ventricular system of the brain. Here you can see the two lateral ventricles there, that is the median third ventricle. The arrow is showing that is third ventricle. And you can see the pair of lateral ventricle. Each lateral ventricle is C-shaped. You can see this is a left lateral ventricle having three horns and a body. And you can see the communication between the lateral ventricle and third ventricle via interventricular foramen of Monroe. And you can see that is third ventricle communicates with the fourth ventricle via cerebral aqueduct. So this is how the three ventricles of the brain are communicating with each other. You can see there, the fourth ventricle communicates below with the central canal of the spinal cord and helps in the circulation of cerebrospinal fluid. So this is the ventricular system of the brain. And what are the functions of these ventricles? Why they are needed? As already stated, they are meant to produce, contain and circulate the cerebrospinal fluid. And what is this cerebrospinal fluid? It is a clear water-like fluid that resides in the ventricular system, and it is around 150 ml in the quantity, and about 0.5 ml is produced every minute, and pressure measures between the 60 to 150 millimeter of water, and contains 15 to 45 milligram of the protein per 100 ml of the fluid, 50 to 85 milligram of the glucose, 720 to 750 milligram of the chloride per 100 ml of the cerebrospinal fluid, and usually contain 1 to 3 lymphocytes per cubic millimeter. And all these parameters are very important in the CSF examination to differentiate different kinds of meningitis, bacterial, viral and parasitic and tubercular. So this composition is significant. And how the CSF is produced? The CSF is produced by the choroid plexus. What is this choroid plexus? So choroid plexus is a vascular plexus or fringe covered by the pyameter, and which is lined by the ependymal cells of the ventricular cavity. It will help in the production of CSF. You can see here, you are seeing the three ventricles. This is the lateral ventricle, third ventricle, and this is the fourth ventricle. Each ventricle has this vascular plexus surrounded by the pyameter and lined by the ependyma in each ventricle, and they are involved in the production of CSF. And these ventricles with their communication help in the circulation of CSF around the central nervous system. And you can see here, the choroid plexus is highlighted in one of the lateral ventricles. You can see the pair of lateral ventricles here in each hemisphere, one in each hemisphere. And how does this CSF circulates? So, as we already told you, the choroid plexus of each ventricle produces it. So, from the choroid plexus of the lateral ventricle, the CSF is produced. It enters the lateral ventricle, and via interventricular foramen of Monroe, it reaches the third ventricle. Even the choroid plexus of third ventricle produces the CSF. From third ventricle to fourth ventricle, it reaches via cerebral aqueduct. Even the choroid plex of fourth ventricle produces CSF, and from fourth ventricle through the lateral and medial apertures, it reaches the subarachnoid space and cisterns. Cisterns are usually the enlarged subarachnoid spaces. They are called as cisterna pontine, cisterna magna. So these are enlarged spaces around the brainstem and around the cerebrum. And from there, it reaches the arachnoid granulations of the dural venous sinuses and enter the venous blood and enter the circulatory system. So this is how the cerebrospinal fluid flows throughout the ventricular system. So the choroid plex of each ventricle is producing the CSF, but the CSF from the lateral ventricle reaches the third ventricle via interventricular foramen of Monroe, from third to fourth via cerebral aqueduct, and from fourth to the subarachnoid space, which is covering the entire brain, via these subarachnoid space and cisternas, and reach the arachnoid granulations of the dural venous sinuses, where they are going to be absorbed. You can see here just a diagrammatic representation of the circulation of CSF. So third lateral ventricle is producing there, it reaches the third ventricle via foramen of Monroe. From there it reaches the fourth ventricle via cerebral aqueduct, and from fourth ventricle through its median aperture called as foramen of Magendie, and lateral apertures called as foramen of Lushka. You can remember as median aperture as Magendie, M for M, lateral aperture for the foramen of Lushka, L for L. And from there they reach the subarachnoid space surrounding the entire brain, and this is how they circulate in the subarachnoid space surrounding the brain, and they are going to get absorbed here in the arachnoid granulations of the dural venous sinuses. From dural venous sinuses it reaches the general circulation. You can see the arachnoid granulations here in one of the dural venous sinuses. Here it is superior sagittal sinus, where they absorb this CSF and involve it in the general circulation. So you can see, how this is how the CSF flows in this image here. This is how the entire CSF flow occurs within the ventricular system, involving the subarachnoid space. And coming to the factors responsible for the flow of CSF, it is the pulsation of the cerebral and spinal arteries, movements of the vertebral column, respiration and coughing, and also change in the positions help in the CSF flow. And what are the functions of this CSF, why it is needed? So it cushions and protects the central nervous system from the trauma. It provides the support and mechanical buoyancy to the brain so that brain can weigh less. And it nourishes the entire central nervous system. It removes the metabolites from the central nervous system and acts as a reservoir and regulates the contents of the skull. So these are the functions of CSF. Next, move on to the third ventricle. So what is this third ventricle? How many third ventricles are there? Only one third ventricle is there. So third ventricle and fourth ventricle are single in number, lateral ventricles are paired, and they communicate with each other by the different communications. So let us move to the third ventricle. So what is this third ventricle? It represents the primitive cavity of the forebrain vesicle. You should remember that these ventricles are derived from the central canal of the primitive neural tube. The upper end of the neural tube will form three swellings: prosencephalon, mesencephalon, and rhombencephalon or hindbrain, forebrain, midbrain, and hindbrain. Those cavities become ventricle here. So the third ventricle represents the primitive cavity of the forebrain vesicle during the development of CNS. You can see here, it is the median ventricle. So it is also known as an interthalamic space, because it lies between the two thalamus, right and left thalami, in the median plane. You can see in the coronal section above and the sagittal section below. And it presents the following features. It has an anterior wall, roof, posterior wall, floor, and two lateral walls. That is the anterior wall, roof, posterior wall, and floor, and having the two lateral walls. One lateral wall you can see in this sagittal section, that is the lateral wall of the third ventricle. You can see the two lateral walls here in the form of two thalami. So it is also known as interthalamic space. So next, moving on to the other parts and relations. And coming to the anterior wall, it is formed before backwards by the lamina terminalis, which is the rostral end of the central canal of the primitive neural tube during development. Anterior commissure, one of the commissural fibers, which communicates the orbital surface of the both the frontal lobes. Then fornix, it is the positional fibers of the hippocampus. So here you can see, this is the anterior wall formed by the lamina terminalis, anterior commissure, and anterior column of the fornix. Then coming to the roof, it is formed by the tilac choroidea. It is formed by the pyameter and the ependymal cell lining, tilac choroidea of the third ventricle, body of the fornix, and choroid plexus. Choroid plexus is a vascular plexus covered by the pyameter and lined by the ependymal cells that we have discussed before. So that is the roof of the third ventricle formed by these three structures. And coming to the posterior wall here, it is formed by the suprapineal recess, pineal body with the pineal recess and commencement of cerebral aqueduct. That you can see, you can also see Habenula commissure in the upper area of the pineal gland, and posterior commissure in the lower lamella of the stalk of the pineal gland. So that is the posterior wall. You can see the suprapineal recess, the pineal recess, commencement of cerebral aqueduct, and here you can see there the habenular commissure in the upper lamella of the stalk of the pineal gland, and in the lower lamella you are seeing the posterior commissure. Whereas the floor, it is formed before backwards by the optic chiasma, where the two optic nerves meet, and a tuber cinereum, median hollow eminence in the base of the brain, that is having the capillaries and nerve fibers. The capillaries of tuber cinereum form the hypophyseal portal system, and it contains the nerve fibers which emerge from the hypothalamus and going to the posterior lobe or posterior part of the pituitary gland, carrying the hormones in the form of secretions. Then you will see the infundibulum of the pituitary gland, that is which connects the pituitary gland to the base of the brain. Then mammillary body, pair of these rounded bodies. Structurally they are part of diencephalon, but functionally they are related to limbic system, and they are connected to dorsomedial nucleus and anterior nucleus of thalamus by mammillothalamic tract, and have some role in recollective memory, because the thiamine deficiency which damages the mammillary bodies results in the Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome, resulting in anterograde amnesia. So any damage to the mammillary body can lead to spatial memory loss. So that will tell you that it has a role in memory. Then posterior perforated substance, that's a depressed area here, you can see, having been covered by the gray matter, and it gives a pathway to the perforating branches of the arteries. So these are the structures. You will see, along with that, you will see a subthalamic prolongation of the midbrain. So these are the structures forming the floor. So you can see optic chiasma, it's the entire floor of the third ventricle, optic chiasma, then you will see infundibulum, mammillary body, posterior perforated substance, and midbrain. So all these structures which are also part of interpeduncular fossa. So you can see here optic chiasma, infundibulum, the pituitary gland with infundibulum, mammillary body, then posterior perforated substance, and lastly the tegmental part of the midbrain having the cerebral peduncles. So these all are the parts of or contents of interpeduncular fossa. So let us see what is interpeduncular fossa. You can see in the base or a floor of the third ventricle, you will see the interpeduncular fossa, and all those structures what we discussed are observed in the interpeduncular fossa. It is a somewhat rhomboid shaped area of in the base of the brain that you can see, and it is limited in front by the optic chiasma and behind by the superior surface of the pons. You can see here will be the interpeduncular fossa, roughly rhomboid shape. So here is the optic chiasma, and here will be the pons or ventral surface of the pons. And when you see the anterolaterally and posterolaterally, it is bounded by the diverging optic tracts and diverging cerebral peduncles. That is the optic chiasma. This is the optic tract, right and left, going into the lateral geniculate body of the thalamus. And posterolaterally, we are seeing the diverging cerebral peduncles of the midbrain. So here is the contents of interpeduncular fossa, what you see. So anteriorly the optic chiasma, posteriorly the pons, anterolaterally optic tract, posterolaterally you are seeing cerebral peduncles, and here you will see all these things. You will see optic chiasma here, then infundibulum, tuber cinereum, that is the median eminence, mammillary bodies, and here you are seeing posterior perforated substance. So these are things what you see in interpeduncular fossa are forming the floor of the third ventricle. So as you see here, you can see the different contents of this fossa. From anterior to posterior, if you go, you are seeing optic chiasma, tuber cinereum, infundibulum is there, and you are seeing pair of mammillary bodies. They are called as mammillary bodies because they resemble breasts or mamma. And here you will see posterior perforated substance. So you can remember them as eye stomp, eye for infundibulum, and you can see here I for infundibulum, S for subthalamus, T for tuber cinereum, optic chiasma, mammillary bodies, and posterior perforated substance. So these are the contents of this interpeduncular fossa. And coming to the lateral wall of the third ventricle, it is an interthalamic space. So lateral wall should be formed by thalamus and hypothalamus. You can see the lateral wall presents the hypothalamic sulcus here, that is visible, which divides the lateral wall into postero superior area and antero inferior area. And you will see the postero superior area is formed by the thalamus, whereas antero inferior area is formed by the hypothalamus. So this hypothalamic sulcus, which is extending from the foramen of Monroe to the opening of the cerebral aqueduct, diagonally divides the lateral wall into thalamus and hypothalamus. That is this, you can see, that is hypothalamic sulcus, hypothalamus, this is thalamus, and you will see a thalamic adhesion there, interthalamic adhesion. And finally, summarizing the relations of the third ventricle, so anterior wall is formed by the three things: anterior column of fornix, anterior commissure, and lamina terminalis. We have discussed about that in detail. Then the roof, the posterior wall is formed by the pineal gland, posterior commissure, and beginning of the cerebral aqueduct. Roof is formed by the telechoridae of the third ventricle, the body of the fornix, and septum pellucidum. So here you have seen that the telecoid of third ventricle, the fornix and septum pellucidum, and the floor is formed by the contents of the interpeduncular fossa or stompy. You can remember it as stompy or eye stomp, whatever I told you, or remember them in a serial order, that is by the optic chiasma, infundibulum, tuber sinarium, mammillary body, posterior perforated substance, and subthalamic prolongation of the midbrain. So these are the structures which form the floor of the third ventricle. And in lateral wall, what you have, thalamus and hypothalamus supported by the hypothalamic sulcus. So here you can see in the animation, when you are seeing the left cerebral hemisphere, we are going to take out the left cerebral hemisphere, you are going to see the left lateral ventricle. Lateral ventricle is present in each cerebral hemisphere. You can see that is the anterior horn and the body. That is the inferior horn and posterior horn of the lateral ventricle. That is the lenticular nucleus surrounded by the caudate nucleus. Corpus striatum they are forming there. And when you remove that, you are seeing the thalamus. You are seeing the left thalamus here. It is the collection of different nuclei for the sensory integration and relay. If you remove the left thalamus, so third ventricle being the interthalamic space will be visible now, you can see. So that is the median interthalamic space representing the primitive cavity of the forebrain during development. That is the third ventricle. Yes, here you can see the third ventricle having the anterior wall, roof, posterior wall and floor. You can now visualize the location and the parameters of the third ventricle. That is the medial nuclei of thalamus. We'll take out that. And coming to the relations, what are the superior relations? Superior relations are the fornix that you see there. That is the fornix. And you will see telechoridae of third ventricle, that is septum pellucidum. These are the structures which form the superior wall, that is corpus callosum. And anteriorly, you are going to see the anterior column of fornix, that is the projection fibers of the hippocampus and lamina terminalis. As already told, it is the rostral end of the central canal of the neural tube during development. It represents the upper end. Anterior commiger, a commigeral fiber which connects the orbital surface of the both frontal lobes, involved in the process of the smell, behavior and responses to pain. Whereas the base is formed by the, or floor of the third ventricle is formed by the contents of interpeduncular fossa, that is optic chiasma, infundibulum of the pituitary gland, that you can see pituitary gland there, that is the infundibulum. And as you go posteriorly, you are going to see the hypothalamus there, and you are going to see the mammillary bodies, pair of mammillary bodies concerned with the limbic system. They are structurally, they are part of diencephalon. Functionally, they are related to limbic system, concerned with the recollective memory. So these are the structures forming the floor of the third ventricle. So coming to the posterior wall, what you see there posteriorly, you will see suprapineal recess, pineal recess. So this is about the relations of the third ventricle. So hope you had a fruitful session. and a proper understanding of the third ventricle with the animation and a 3D model. Thank you. See you soon.